Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala hama ba'd. Today let's do something different, inshallah ta'ala. Let's do a little bit of history, inshallah. This is from memory, so if I make some mistakes, then names or dates, inshallah, then just correct it on the video, I guess, inshallah. I gave a khutbah about Islam in India. It's useful for us to know the origins of Islam in that land. And when was the first time that Muslims came, and what was the story, and what happened? It is mentioned in our books of history that even in the time of the Khulafa al-Rashidun, Umar ibn al-Khattab and Uthman radiallahu anh, there were skirmishes with Indian naval forces, Uthman in particular, that Umar radiallahu anh did not want any Muslim naval force. But there were some ships going along and perhaps some minor battles took place, but there was no actual invasion in that time frame. It is also mentioned that maybe in the reign of Muawiyah, because Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was the first one to have an actual naval force. It is mentioned in some books that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu might have had a small port in what is now the Makran province. A small port where, you know, the ships would go and get their supplies, but not military conquest. He just had that port as a basis. The first invasion, as all of us Indian Pakistanis are aware, was by Muhammad ibn Qasim. This was the first invasion. What was the story of this invasion? So in the time of the Khulafa and the early Umayyads, Arabs had already begun to travel for the sake of tijara. And they already had communities in small islands across the Indian Ocean. And they had communities in what is now Sri Lanka. So Arab merchants were buying and selling, trading, and so there was a small group of Muslims as expatriates, as foreigners, not as locals or whatnot, and they had married, intermarried, and they had children from these marriages. It so happened that they didn't go back to Arabia for a long period of time, and they all died, and their children remained Muslim. Their mothers were from locals, and their parents, their fathers are from Arab lands. So the king of Sri Lanka decided as a gift, as a gesture to the Umayyads, to send these children, these boys and girls, back to the Muslim lands as a gift that, you know, we respect, we want to have good relations. So the Sri Lankan king did this. He sent a ship, and the ship had the young ladies and the boys of these Muslim merchants. Pirates from India, pirates intercepted these ships and took these young ladies. You understand why. News reached the Umayyad Caliphate, and the Umayyad Caliphate sent a message to the local Raja, the local king. His name was Dahar or Dahir. The news reached the Umayyad Khalifa, and he sent a message to the closest king. You have to hand these young ladies back to us. They are our children. They are our, you know, ummah. You're not allowed to do this. The Raja says, I'm not doing it, it's the pirates. And I have, these pirates are rebels. I have tried so many years to fight them, I can't fight them. Whether it was real, whether it was an excuse, we don't know. But he refused to get involved. And so, Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, the governor, he became so enraged, he sent his own nephew, Muhammad ibn Qasim. Muhammad ibn Qasim is from the tribe of the Banu Thaqifa as well. He sent his own nephew, Muhammad ibn Qasim, 17-year-old military general, and he armed him with everything, gave him everything that was needed. And he said, destroy this Raja, destroy. He did not stand up when we needed to, so now you need to just get rid of this person. So Muhammad ibn Qasim then landed at Daybal. And Daybal is a drive away from Karachi. You still have the remnants of Daybal to this day. I'm not sure, an hour, or I don't know if anybody's been there, they can tell me, but I think it's an hour away from Karachi, 45 minutes from Karachi. So he landed at Daybal, and this is when the expansion began. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed that generation. It was, I have no doubt in my mind, it is miracle after miracle. If you read how the Muslims conquered that region and Khurasan and Mawara al-Nahr and, you know, the Sassanid Empire and the Roman Empire, there's no question that generation was blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their iman, their taqwa, the barakah of that generation, we have never seen it, you know, ever since then. So Muhammad ibn Qasim begins conquering. Raja Dahir attacks. It is famous battle took place in a city, Brahmanabad. Brahmanabad is a city back then. So in that city, the river Indus was flowing next to it. And one of the Muslim archers threw an arrow with the fire at the end of the arrow. You know that fire that comes. And it hit the elephant of Raja Dahar. So the elephant fell into the river Indus with Raja Dahar on it. So Raja fell into the river, and then the Muslim began attacking until the Raja was killed. With the death of the Raja Dahar, obviously, Brahmanabad was conquered. It was then called Mansura. Okay, Mansura. So the city of Mansura became the original capital of the Muslims of the Sindh province. Karachi, the Sindh province. So the city of Mansura became that capital. And a number of other cities were also created or renamed. Mahfuza was one of them. Multan as well came under Muslim control. So four or five cities were then created in this region of what is now the province of Sindh. Now, one of our problems as historians and as people who are researching this era is that we don't have original documents of that time frame. We do not have the details of what happened. And the next 300 years are very, very murky. There are no large volumes written about the Muslims of India of that time frame. We literally have pages. That is it. Why? Because the action for most of the historians is in Baghdad, it is in Kufa, it is in Damascus, it is in Mecca and Medina. This small province of Mansura and Mahfuza and Makran and Multan, who's writing about that? We have little references in the big Arab historians, Al-Baladhuri, Al-Tabari, we have a paragraph, a small sentence, and that's it. Locally over there, we do not have any preserved histories from eyewitnesses. The earliest history that we have, it is called the Chachnama. This is the earliest history that is written of that time frame. The Chachnama was written in ancient Farsi or medieval Farsi, and it was written around 1300 CE. So that's 1300 CE. So what hijra is that? 700 hijri, right? So 1300 CE, 700 hijri, we have the Chachnama being written. The Chachnama was written in Persian, and the author alleges that he discovered a manuscript in Arabic that was written by an eyewitness under Muhammad ibn Qasim. But this is alleged, and the stories are so romanticized and put into flowery language that we don't know what to believe, what not to believe. So the Chachnama is something that is used, but at the same time, there's an element, because it was written for a king, and anytime you write something for a king, anytime you write something for a ruler, what's gonna happen? You know, you give it some leeway, some extra whatnot. So this is our main problem here. Now we know that the Umayyads continued to send governors to these provinces, but the Umayyads lost the war to the Abbasids. The Abbasids lost interest in that region. It was too far for the Abbasids. They sent a governor or two. They sent a particular governor. That governor died, and so an insurrection took place, and one of the locals basically declared himself to be the Sultan, declared himself to be the governor, not the Sultan, and he said, I am now going to rule on behalf of the Abbasids. And his dynasty became the longest dynasty of this time frame. It is called the Habarid dynasty. The Habarid dynasty. It ruled for 170 years. The Habarid dynasty, its base was Mansura. And it, why is it called the Habarid dynasty? A very interesting story. The fifth generation ancestor of the founder of the dynasty, he was by the Habar ibn Aswad ibn Abd ibn Habar ibn Muttalib ibn, I don't remember his full name, Habbad ibn Muttalib something. He was a second cousin of Khadija. He was a second cousin of Khadija, Habbar. And he was in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and he was an enemy of Islam. When Zainab radiallahu anha wanted to migrate to Medina, he was the one who stood in the way and took his arrow out and wanted to shoot at the camel. The camel reared back, and it is said that Zainab radiallahu anha was pregnant. And so she fell and she miscarried because of Habbar. And that is why when the conquest of Mecca happened, there was a list of people. The Prophet said, these people shall not be forgiven. Habbar's name was on there. But Allah had willed that his descendants would be the first dynasty of what is now Pakistan. So Habbar accepted Islam. hid himself, came to the Prophet ﷺ and begged for forgiveness. And the Prophet ﷺ would forgive anybody who asked for forgiveness. Anybody. When Habbar asked for forgiveness, the Prophet ﷺ forgave him. 5 generations later, because Allah's plan has to take place, his 5th generation descendant was in the city of Mansura. And he founded the Habbarid dynasty from 150 Hijrah to around 300 Hijrah. That was the Habbarid dynasty until Mahmud al-Ghaznavi came. Mahmud al-Ghaznavi came and then took over from the Habbarid dynasty. Now what we do know is that from 150 to 300 Hijrah, that region of Pakistan, well, we call it Pakistan now, it was obviously called Sindh back then. That region of Sindh, it, as is always the case in Muslim history, one of the tragedies of Muslim history, it became divided amongst itself. And rather than being united under one governorship, at least 5 governorships were created. Every city became independent from the other. Every city is boycotting the other, fighting the other. The same thing happened in Andalus. Exact same thing. You had 27 mini dynasties in Andalus at one given time. Can you imagine? What do you think is going to happen when you have 27 dynasties? Of course, you know, Ferdinand and Isabella are going to come and reconquer the entire land. Of course that's going to happen. The Muslim disunity is our problem from day one. Instead of uniting against others, they began fighting amongst themselves. كُلُّ حِزْمٍ بِمَا لَدَيْهِمْ فَرِحُونَ. And so, between these cities, now, we do have one other source of information, and that is just a few paragraphs of travelers that went through these regions and recorded what they saw. Not Ibn Battuta. Ibn Battuta is much later on. We have travelers that came before Ibn Battuta. We have people like Ibn Hawqal. We have people like Al-Istakhri. We have a number of people who traveled through the lands and they visited Mansura, they visited Multan, and they described beautiful gardens. Some of them, one of them says that the people of Mansura, they dress and talk like the people of Iraq, because the conquerors were Iraqi. So 300 years later, and you have a mini Iraq in Pakistan. Mini Iraq, the language is Iraqi, the dialect is Iraqi, the dress is Iraqi in that region. So the traveler describes this. Also interestingly enough, for those that are students of fiqh, we know that the Zahiri Madhab was predominant over there, right? And he actually writes that there's a small group of Hanafis, but the predominant Madhab is the Zahiri Madhab. The Zahiri Madhab, there were 5 Madhab once upon a time. This is the 5th Madhab. It disappeared over time. But it was common in that region until what happened. Another interesting point, all of this is random facts. Another interesting point, so we talked about Mansura. As for Multan, at some point in time, we do not know when, the governor of Multan, for strategic purposes, broke away from the Abbasid Empire, and he declared his allegiance to the Fatimid Empire. And he became Ismaili. So that city followed the thought of a strand of Shi'ism that is called Ismailism, right? And this is the origin of that firqa in that land. Every Indian Pakistani knows what I'm talking about, right? The origin of that firqa, where did it come from? In this time frame, around 200, 250 Hijrah, Multan stopped being Sunni and converted. We do not know why. As far as we know, it could be strategic purposes that instead of speaking, because Mansura always remained technically under the Abbasids, Sunni. Mansura gave its little bit of money and the khutbah was read in the name of the Abbasid caliphate. As for Multan, the travelers that go through describe that Multan reads in the name of the Khalifa of the Fatimids, right? And this is where a group of people converted. They called themselves Khoja at the time. It's a firqa, it's a group. No, it's not a firqa. It was an ethnicity of traders at that time, and they converted to that group. And as we know, people of that region know, their descendants still, they had to adopt, because Ismailism went into different trends. You had the Bohra, you had the Nizari Agha Khani, you had the Druze, and you had all three of these in that region at that time frame. So their antagonism increases, and it was at this point in time when Mahmud al-Ghaznavi, for reasons beyond the scope of these regions, Mahmud al-Ghaznavi decides to attack, and he was the one who then destroyed Multan as a Fatimid province. And he recaptured Mansura, and he then united that region under his famous, you know, Ghaznavid Empire. And then history is recorded. We do have history recorded from Mahmud al-Ghaznavi, one of his secretaries by the name of Al-Utbi. He was a historian. So we have the history of Al-Utbi. It's an eyewitness of the reconquest of Mahmud al-Ghaznavi. Pre-Mahmud al-Ghaznavi, which is from around, so Muhammad ibn Qasim was 91 Hijrah. Mahmud al-Ghaznavi is around, 400 Hijrah, right? So from 91 to 400, this is our dark area. We don't know much because, as I said, we don't have eyewitness historians and we don't have somebody from outside writing in. We just have a little bit of paragraphs. What I have reconstructed, maybe you can add maybe 5-10 times this amount, and that's all that we know from this time frame. Inshallah, maybe another lecture I'll talk about Mahmud al-Ghaznavi, and then of course you have other, you know, dynasties. Maybe another time we'll talk about them. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والخاشعين والخاشعات والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما.